acknowledgement.
Waya waya. Kappa kian iri hei shup loka chumash. Kisuna pai loka nauna wa ai wash. Kisuna pai loka kuku. Kian kiala kumilium. Kakisuna pai washa chitawa khas.
I was speaking Mitzkanakan, Ventureño Chumash. And now I'm going to translate it. We are here gathered on this day, in this world, on this land, where we honor our Chumash ancestors. We also honor the Chumash communities living today and the future Chumash communities to come. We honor and thank you all for the work you are doing today. That is all. Greetings. Let me just take that in. Inhale, exhale. My name is Florencia Ramirez. I am the project director for the Pesticide-Free Project. And I am happy to have us gathered here today for the other Strawberry Festival. We are holding a virtual event today, but hopefully next year will be different. First of all, I want to thank Naira and Alice for interpreting today. I remind you all that you will see a globe icon on the right-hand side of your screen so you can select your language. It's important for us to have this be accessible to many people. And I also want to thank everyone participating in this festival. Things are much more beautiful and powerful when they are done in collaboration. And this is definitely a collaboration. It is a project of Encampment for Citizenship. And thank you for Margot for saying yes to this idea. It is also a collaboration with Tequio, which is a youth group under MICOP. We're also going to hear from the Abundant Table and other organizations that we'll hear coming up next. And so I was thinking about, you know, what am I going to talk about for this event, you know? And so I thought, why not be in my kitchen, right? Our kitchens are full of stories. Sometimes they're pleasant, sometimes they're not. And that's the case with strawberries. Many of us have gone to Strawberry Festival in the past, but there are a lot of aspects that we don't understand about the process of growing strawberries. And it may not be such a sweet story. Growing strawberries in general signifies the exploitation of people, of humans, the use of pesticides. Just in California, over 15 million different pesticides are used across our crops, right? And what does this mean for our people, for our crops, for our land? And so this is also a space for us to gather. And I ask that you come with an open heart and an open mind, because we don't know where these ideas, maybe something that someone says that, you know, can plant a seed in someone that may grow into something good. So that's why this is something that is so important, because we want to understand why this issue matters and how we can move forward in creating, imagining a more beautiful place. And that's truly the point of this event today, is to cross-pollinate, learn from one another, and be with an open mind and an open heart, because we don't know what's coming after these times in which we share together. And so with that, I'm going to hand it over to Dalia, who is going to introduce the poetry readings. This has come about from a poetry contest, and we have some poets who will be sharing their pieces with us that they submitted to for the contest. So Dalia, I'll hand it over to you. Hello, my name is Dalia Garcia, and I am a member of the Tequio youth group. I am Mixtec from the San Juan Juxtepec, Oaxaca region. And right now I am going to introduce the youth who will be sharing their pieces, poetry through which they'll express their emotions and how they understand food justice. As we know, poetry has been a means through which we express our deepest thoughts and feelings, you know, how our souls, our spirits are doing. And poetry has always been a medium to express these and make it accessible to other people, to connect their emotions and knowledge. So the first person we will start with, it'll be a poem by Alexis Juarez. She should be on Zoom right now, but we have a video through which she is sharing her poem. Hello, everybody. My name is Alexis Juarez. I'm 22. I was raised here in the 805. My family has been working these fields for four generations, and that's what I'm going to talk about, the culture of farm workers. Si conoces la cultura del campesino, it's big expectations in small households. It's sueños of sweet citrus salted with our strong will and spiced with our sacrifices. It's turning a 6 a.m. hungry belly into 5 full frijolitos. La cultura del campesino is conscious of economic inequality and exploitation. Feel free to farm the fruits of my labors. Our roots run four generations deep. Si conoces la cultura del campesino, it's freeing familias from familiar hunger pains. It's fathers falsifying faded labels to surprise our señoras with fresh fruta. La cultura del campesino is a community of color creating the counter-narrative to conquest. ¿Sí conoces la cultura del campesino? Do you know the culture of farm workers? Thank you. Thank you so much, Alexis, for this beautiful poem. The next participant will be a poem from Piper Snowbear. Piper Snowbear, are you ready? Yes, I'm ready. Hello, my name is Piper Snowbear. The topic of food injustice is something that I feel strongly about. My privilege has allowed me to be constant access to food and to access certain ignorance. And of course, I was conscious of people asking for money on the streets. But what I never realized is how critical of an issue this is. And since then, I've learned how critical this issue of food security is, which is layered in so many aspects of classism and racism. and we need to unpack these ideologies to understand that this food access does not have to be a luxury. It needs to be an access for everyone. So my poem is called Spit Out Your Money, Swallow Your Food. Each time you swallow, can you feel the chains? Do you taste the cold metal at the back of your throat where your tongue meets the roof of your mouth? Can you actually taste your food, or is money all you can taste? Have you become a sink? Do you feel your money slipping down the drain with each bite you swallow? Replace the apple in your mouth with a $1 bill. How does it taste? Does it fill up the empty space in your stomach? Do the molecules bury themselves in your bones, dance around your stomach, swim through your veins, and seep through your tissues? Not with a dollar bill, they don't. Does your mind gyrate with the anxiety of not knowing how or when you will next be able to put a plate in front of yourself and your kids? Are you wrapped in the vines of your money? Do they reach down your throat and fill your esophagus, making it impossible to eat? Are you consuming, or are you being consumed? Why must we spit out money so we can swallow food? We're drowning in food, yet many are in a drought. Thank you so much, Piper. Your words are heard and really taken in as we consider these issues. And finally, we have our last participant, Leo Ortega, with a poem.
Sí, estoy presente. Y yo ando cuidando de esa ventana, está siendo oportunidad.
I'm from Oaxaca, and many people know it as my region as Santiago Tlihuapa. And I am Mixtec, and I am grateful to be here. And I'm grateful to be here and share this poem. This poem will be talking about my mother as an indigenous woman, as a farm worker. And I have a picture of her. I don't know if I can share it so that I can share what my mom looks like as I read the poem. Oh, there you go. Here it is. Are you guys able to see this? A beautiful lady from the land of the rain who crossed many desert fields, cackling at the world. Very beautiful. I thought she would never grow old. She is the most beautiful woman of my life. You are the woman who gave me this life. Without you, there is no me. You taught me a lot since I was a child about the person I am today, my mother. Your knowledge, your wisdom, is always counted. Your features of the Mixtec region. You are the hardest working person I've ever met. Your will and compassion has touched many people from here to the mountains across Oaxaca. You gave us the best example. You never criticize anyone. You welcome others with an open heart. You changed the person I am. You taught me about life and its lessons. You taught me to be myself. Madre Linda, I cannot describe the love I have for you, but I can tell you that it is infinite. And so this poem is basically about my mom. As you all can see, I admire, I love her as a woman, as a farm worker. And that's it. Thank you. Thank you so much, Leo. Hearing your poem reminds us that just as we think the Mother Earth, we must also thank our actual mothers, those who give us life, who sustain us, feed us, who wake up early to make tortillas or go through about their days with the goal of feeding our families. So thank you to everyone. Thanks to Alexis, Piper, and Leo again. And just reminding all of you who are present that we still have this competition going on. So we invite all young people to participate so that your voices, your thoughts, feelings can be heard around this topic about food justice. And also, we want your voices to be heard. And the competition will end June 9th. So there's time for youth to still participate in this competition. And I'm going to hand it over to Kiki. Thank you so much, Dalia. I don't know what language to speak, but let's see, I'm going to speak Spanish. I'm sorry, I'm going to speak English, or maybe a little bit of both, but we have incredible interpreters, so that's fine. My name is Kiki, and this section is not about me, but about the youth who will be presenting. But I work for the Abundant Table, which is a natural organic farm that does a lot of education about farm worker issues and food justice. And we have been talking about all the ways in which we can, you know, engage with the strawberry agriculture and connect that to our community. And we've had the other strawberry festival before, and opportunities for people to visit our farm and have people see how strawberries are grown. And it's a very beautiful experience to have people connect to these issues. And since we have interpretation, I remind you all that we need to speak slowly so that the interpreters can capture everything we say. But we invite you to speak in whatever language you'd like, in English or Spanish. And we're going to invite the youth to share their experiences for 3 to 5 minutes. The youth we have here today are Sofia, Leslie, Leo, Guadalupe, Sarai. And this is going to be, you all giving a testimony about your connection to food, this unjust food system. How do you feel about accessing organic food? And what stories do you have regarding farm worker labor, and how do you feel about that? And then you'll have time to answer any questions you'd like. I'll also do some follow-up questions, but also feel free to ask questions in the chat. So we'll get started with Sofia. Thank you very much. My name is Sofia Altamirano, and I come from the Nusavi Mixtec community. I come from a town called Itiantun, also known as Santiago Tilapa. And we speak Tunsavi, which is the Mixtec language. And my family, my mom, my uncles, my chitos, my shishis, my tias, you know, we all come from a farm worker community. Most of us working in the strawberry fields. And I think that even for me, working in the fields, or having my brother and my mom currently working in the fields, well, there's a lot of knowledge that our family has, but also a lot of pain that we carried for seeing my mother work there for over 28 years. I see the pain surfacing from her body. You know, it's hard to see watching my mom wake up at 3 a.m. and sometimes not coming home until 6 a.m. And it's just constantly seeing her on the daily and not being able to enjoy her presence. It's something that is very difficult to see how, you know, she's given food to so many people, you know, fed people all over the world, but sometimes she hasn't even been able to feed her own children. And so that's something that I wanted to talk about. And just simply seeing how beautiful my community is, despite having to overcome so many struggles, you know, seeing so many artists and poets share their experiences in their language as well. That was very beautiful and empowering. And that's it. Thank you. Thank you so much, Sophia. Maybe we can move on with Yesenia. Hello, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Yesenia. I come from Oaxaca. I was born there in Oaxaca, and I was born in a town called San Jose La Chirigui. And almost my entire family are farm workers, my mom, my dad. And I think that throughout all these years that I've seen my mom and dad working in the fields, I think for me and for children of farm workers, there's a lot of trauma, and for the farm workers as well. What I've seen, particularly in communities, is that a lot of children don't know how to communicate with their parents because they spend a lot of time apart. They don't spend time as a family unit. A lot of the farm workers have to leave their kids with a babysitter for long periods of time. And that builds a trauma that the children grow up with, believing that their parents don't love them. But the truth is that these children don't realize how difficult it is for their parents to be separated and be so far away from their family. So for me, for example, I've seen my mom and dad come leave work with their dirt stained hands, and seeing their hands growing up, I always thought it was blood, but it was stained from the strawberries, right? But it is something very difficult for children to witness, you know, seeing your parents coming home from work hurting and you can't do anything for them. And that affected me. I'm sorry. That really affected me. Because I couldn't do anything for them. And I think there's a lot of trauma being a farm worker or being a child and not being able to do anything for your parents. And that's why I keep fighting, and I like doing this type of work, so that not just myself or other children no longer suffer, but that things change so that they are more just and they get paid adequately so they can spend more time with their children. And that's why I like doing this work of sharing my story and sharing other stories. Thank you, Yesenia. Leslie, we will move on with Leslie. Hello, my name is Leslie Villega. I have lots of memories related to strawberries. I have worked with my parents since I was 15 years old, picking strawberries each summer. My parents have worked in the fields for almost 10 years. And when I see my parents come home from work, I see their dirty hands, their clothes full of sweat and stains. And I experienced four times what they have lived through for 10 years. I grew up thinking it was easy work, but it's not at all. My siblings, my aunts and uncles, they all worked in those fields, and I'm proud of what they've done for me. I'm conscious that they couldn't give me everything, but I'm always grateful. Every time I see vegetables or fruits, I think of my family. Thank you so much, Leslie. Thank you all for sharing all these stories, because they're so deep, and we're going to touch back on these points to have a deeper dialogue. But up next, we have Guadalupe. Hi, everyone. My name is Guadalupe. I'm originally from Oaxaca, from Santiago, Juxtla, Oaxaca, and I came here at 8 years old. So I've been here most of my life. But even so, I remember a lot of aspects of where I grew up and my time there. But yes, I came here when I was 8 years old, and I still remember everything that my parents had to go through working in the fields. We would travel back and forth between the strawberry and grape fields. What they enjoyed most is picking grapes, taking off the leaves off from the vines. And that's what I started doing when I was 13. I still remember that summer because one day we woke up and they told us, sorry, we need help today, so you're coming with us. And they woke me up. I got dressed. I did not know what I was going to go do. I just knew I was going to go work. And like I said, I was 13 years old. I think starting the junior high, I don't remember. But, you know, since I would work in the grape fields every summer, that previous summer I had started working in the strawberry fields and I would help with what I could. But since I'm a woman and I'm short and I was young, you know, the majority of our community is pretty short. We're pretty short people. And so I just had to cover my face with a handkerchief. And the managers, believed that I was of age to work. And so that's how I started. And I didn't know anything, you know. I would just try to do the work. And that's where I realized how hard my parents had to work. You know, being under the sun for 10 hours in one day, it's heartbreaking. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. No, Lupe, I think we're all feeling the same with everyone's stories. It is an honor to be able to hear you and share with you. So please share only what you're comfortable with. Yes, it's just that I keep hearing these stories and I connect deeply to them. You know, it's sad to see what is happening with our parents because they work so hard to get us ahead, but it's hard. I have little sisters. And I would not want to see them go through the same that I had to go through and that I had to see. So I try to be an example to them. And, you know, it's humble work, right? And And I've seen them do that for 10, 15 years. And it's very, you know, humble, honorable work. It's nothing for us to be ashamed of. But I wouldn't want to see that my 13-year-old daughter, sister has to do the same. And it's hard to know that they have to depend on us to help them financially, to be that support and be an example to our older, our younger siblings. So it is hard to see, witness that with our parents and especially now that they're older. So that's all I wanted to share. Thank you, Lupe. Sending you so much love. I think, you know, everyone is speaking some very familiar truths that we don't usually get to share. And we are so honored to be able to hear this. And hopefully we can open up about our stories, because it can help us heal to listen to other stories. So thank you, Lupe. We'll get back to you in a bit, but let's move on with Leo and Sarai. And Leo, are you ready? Yeah, I'm ready. Yeah, all the stories that everyone's sharing, they're very similar to mine. I started working when I was young too. Like in junior high. At first I would see it as a punishment. My parents would tell me that I have to go to work. I really didn't realize what was going on for my parents at that time. But when I started working, I started witnessing different experiences. It just opened up my mind. It made me realize what it means to be a farm worker. You know, the time I spent working in the fields, I was able to experience the discrimination and racism towards farm workers, especially coming from the big companies. Farm owners would come to us, especially the indigenous farm workers, the Oaxaqueños, and, you know, they would pick on us because we didn't know how to speak Spanish or English, and they would take advantage of that. And that really inspired or motivated me to speak up for my people. You know, like, I still work in the fields to this day. But, you know, at this moment, I've chosen to join forces with farmwork organizations. Like, I volunteered with MyCop and Cause, and I've built conscience about what's happening in my community. So it does break my heart to see that there are so many people that take advantage of indigenous communities, especially those of us that come from Mexico and that are looking for new opportunities, and that when we come here, it's not what they expect. It's much worse. You know, it's much worse than how it is even in our homelands. And I see families that don't even have enough food or money or don't have access to different resources. Or maybe they don't know where to get the information they need, or they don't know the language because they only speak Mixteco or maybe Tequio or Zapoteco. And I heard about MyCop, and yeah, when I heard about them, I got so happy. You know, it's just been 2 years that they've been in Santa Maria, but it made me feel like, wow, it gave me a sense of hope in this community that I don't know how to explain it, but it's something that we should all be part of. Especially the indigenous community and all workers should be able to feel at home, and they shouldn't feel less than what they are. And it's difficult for me to explain, you know, these things clearly, but this is what we have experienced working in the fields, that our people don't have access to the resources they need and that they face discrimination. And, you know, not so long ago, we took part in a strike because workers went on strike to demand fair wages, right? Because they get taken advantage of. They're not seen as people. They're seen as others. You know, if they're not willing to work themselves out for that money, then they'll just find someone who will work for even less wages. And so it's those kinds of things that make me angry. And that's why I want to be part of something, you know. I want to be like a community organizer or something, you know, support the organizations helping them in this way. Thank you, Leo. Thank you so much for sharing. And now we are going to go on with our next person to share, Sarai. Hi, everyone. I'm Sarai. I'm here with the Pesticide-Free Soil Project. I'm from Oaxaca and Guerrero. And what I wanted to share is that growing up in Oxnard, we were surrounded by agriculture, by fields. So many of our neighbors and friends are farm workers. And that's what my mom did when she just moved to the U.S. She was much younger than me, and she had to pick strawberries to help her family. And my cousins are farm workers. And I remember talking with my cousin about the strawberry festival that goes on here in Ventura County. And she told me that she had never gone to that festival. And that's a pattern that we see. And it's a sign of all these issues that are going on, because the people who produce, literally grow this food, and then bring in income for this community, don't have access to basic things like food. It's very expensive to afford food, much less organic food. And so I'm really happy to hear about all of these youth that have similar experiences and can recognize how unjust the system is. And that's what I wanted to share today. Thank you so much. Everyone who has shared is, you know, you all being so specific on these issues, but there's just common threads through everything that you all are saying. So I have a few questions in mind, but I wonder if you're interested in or willing to share and contributing in this dialogue. We could do so. Maybe you can put an asterisk in the chat in case you're not able to raise your hand and you want to be involved in this dialogue. So I wonder if, with all these stories that we've heard, you know, because I was born and raised here in the 805. And I've seen the industrial exploitation that we see here to this day. And I'm almost 43 years old, so it's been a while, right? And these conditions have not changed. And I know that from the beginning, I never wanted to work in the field, you know, because people, you know, kind of the tradition was that if you go to school, you don't work in the fields, or it's either or, you know. But eventually I went to visit indigenous communities on their lands in Palestine and Mexico, and they taught me about different ways to be with the land in a respectful manner, in a way that didn't reinforce exploitation, which is all I knew here. And so since then, I've been thinking and dialoguing with friends. And I have a friend who's from Palestine, whose name is Vivian. She says, you know, farm workers, they they are in constant ceremony and dance with the land when they're back in their homelands. But when they migrate and they have to be industrial farm workers, they become machines. And that's what I see in the 805. And often I ask myself, does anybody ever ask how you would grow or cultivate these crops in your homeland? No, nobody asks us that, right? They just make us work as they want us to work. And so there's just a lot of hidden gems and stories that I imagine your parents have about how they used to work with the land in their native lands in Oaxaca or Guerrero, or that maybe by then their lands had already been stripped away from them, right? Because, that's something real, right? People have lost their lands all across Mexico and Central America. But I'm just wondering if any of you have had the curiosity to ask your parents, your guardians or uncles and aunts about the ways they used to work with the land. And I think, Leo, you were explaining a little bit about how your mom would have a little tomato plant, right? And how she cared for it. So I just, has anybody asked themselves, or would you be interested in asking your families about that? Or Guadalupe, you still remember Oaxaca, so do you ask yourself about that in your memories? So that's a general question for anybody who wants to answer it without putting anyone in the spotlight. Leo? Okay, so Lupe and then Leo. What I remember is, as a child, I know that my mom used to work in the fields as well. And, you know, she worked from city to city. And what I remember is that they just treated the land differently. And they saw the land in Mexico in a more connected way. And here it feels more selfish. Like in Mexico, before planting seeds, they would let the land rest for 1 or 2 years before deciding to sow any seeds there, just to make sure that the land had what it needed. So they just treated it in such a beautiful way before even deciding what to plant. And so in this way, they would talk about, you know, they would thank the land. And that because of that, you know, the land would be grateful and the fruit would come out sweet as gratitude for that treatment. Yes, thank you for sharing, Leo. Yeah, my mom works a lot in the field, but she also works in my patio. It's full of so many plants, chiles, squash, tomatoes. And she says that it reminds her of her home, of that connection that she has with the land. And I've seen her, you know, when I'm outside, I have a lot of curiosity, and I notice that she treats plants like human beings, like children. She talks to them. She'll say like, "Oh, you're growing up very nice. You're very beautiful." I don't know how to describe it, but she's just giving them the love that they need, the support that they need to grow. And I've seen that too. Like she always talks about the strawberry fields because she works in those fields, and she'll bring strawberries home and she'll talk about the strawberries. I don't know, like it just reminds me about the ways that indigenous women are connected to the land, obviously, right? And religion plays a part of it, but having a connection with the land at the same time, I don't know. she's you know, very Catholic. So, you know, she doesn't really understand how things grow, but she always says the reason that this is growing is because it's God's doing, right? And you know, it's a lot deeper than that, but I like that she puts it that way. Thank you so much, Leo. And Adriana has her hand raised. Hi, everyone. My name is Adriana, and I am here with Tequio. I would like to share a little bit of what you all are talking about. So I also come from a family of farm workers. We have been working for a very long time. And we have had other opportunities as well, which has been good to work elsewhere. But, you know, I have thought about this. Like, I need to ask my grandma more about this. Like, how our people would work the land in a different way based off of our culture. Because as Guadalupe and Leo mentioned, our communities are truly connected to the land. And something that, you know, my parents would tell me growing up working in the fields and telling, you know, whenever we would sit for a lunch break or to rest, you know, they, you know, my dad, you know, would be drinking water and he'd open up his bottle and he'd take a drink and close it. And I would, and then he would also like pour it out and then he would close his bottle. And I would be like, Dad, what are you doing? And he's like, this is what we do to thank the land. You know, before taking care of ourselves, we need to take care of the land because the land gives us food. And so, you know, if we think about it really deeply, it's like they have so much to share that is wisdom. Thank you, Adriana, for mentioning that. Yeah, this is so much knowledge coming from our families. And when it's not passed on, it can disappear. And something that is fascinating but not surprising with the climate catastrophe that we are facing is, you know, needing to learn from indigenous people all over the world about how to care for the land, because this is this wisdom is thousands of years old, right? And it's not about us trying to dominate the land. It should be about us working with the land. So that's what we want to try to come back to, right? And we need to understand that those of us who come from these stories, we have, you know, this residue of trauma and shame. And for those of us who come from communities who have worked in the fields, it's seen as something that has little values. But as we saw with COVID, hopefully our entire country can recognize that there's so much labor required to do what farm workers do. There's also something about learning and asking questions about these stories that allows us to understand that the majority of farm workers in California and all across the country, they hold knowledge that nobody's asking them about, right? They're just being asked to use their bodies as machines. And it's a system that is so unjust, but it's so inspiring to see so many young people taking off from this trauma and pain and transforming it into something more beautiful and just for all of us. And it's also very, you know, I saw a thread with everything that you all shared about, you know, holding on to this responsibility, especially for the older children in the family to help take care of the home, you know. I'm the youngest in my family, and even then I had to contribute. I had to put in work. It was strange to ask my parents for money. But there's something beautiful in that if we can see how that allows for so much strength and resilience to be built through our families and communities. And through that, we can reconcile these experiences, right? And before wrapping up, I just want to see if any of the other panelists want to share about this topic or any other ideas about food justice. We have a few minutes left, but you can also ask questions amongst yourself. Well, I can just add a little bit about what some of my peers were sharing. I know that in my community and town, most of our families, we live on our lands, but also sometimes we have to buy back our lands to be able to grow on it. And I know that my mother used to tell me that they would always be growing, planting something. I know that they used to grow corn, and I would witness this process when they had this thing they would use, a tool that they used to grind the corn and to turn it into, masa, or what we call shita, to turn it into a tortilla. And to see here how we live in apartments and we don't have the space to, plant anything. But even then, my mom still has her little yerbabuena, spearmint plant. You know, she likes to use that in food. And even though she doesn't have access to these spaces, we do have families that have their own garden of different vegetables, just traditional foods. And I've seen, homes, my cousins' homes, then they're growing their own chayote, right? They hang it and it grows. And this is like a squash, right? And, some friends will sometimes say when we come over, like, oh, we have this plant. Do you want some of this? And so we share our food with each other. So I just wanted to share that. Thank you. You illustrated such a beautiful imagery and sharing amongst your community. So we have a lot of love coming from the chat right now, lots of hearts. And there's a question, Sandy, about whether there are growers that do treat their workers well. And if so, is there a way to highlight or promote these positive working relations as a way to also highlight the ways that there are exploitative growers? Would this be useful in motivating or educating those who are buying produce? That way we could maybe write letters to unjust growers. And thank you for sharing your stories. There's also another comment on here thanking you all for sharing your stories and for sharing all this love with us. Well, I can share that I know there are a lot of fields that belong to large companies here. I do see that there are smaller growers that rent land and they grow their produce and sell it in farmers markets. And I think the most appropriate thing would be to ask where the food is coming from. I know that it's usually sold back to the company and they get very little in return. I know that for a box of tomatoes, I've seen them sell it for $10. From that person who grew it, selling it to the company, is sold for very little. But then I see the company selling it for much more. And I don't see how the growers themselves benefit in a just way by what they are growing. Thank you for that. here in the comments, we have a resource that was recommended, a Soulfire Farm in New York. And it's been very interesting to see how in the last decade, a movement has unfolded for a movement for Black, Indigenous, and people of color to just develop, grow more just visions. And I know that me and a few other comrades from Oxnard, we went to Detroit to learn more about these efforts. And immediately we saw that in these urban Detroit spaces, we saw a huge difference in who was growing and working in certain areas between Black and white people. You know, we saw that white people would grow for profit, but Black growers were growing for their own liberation, or as to say that they no longer wanted to depend on a system that exploits their workers. And so, you know, in that process, we learned about respect and how to respect workers within this food system. And in, we, you know, also being in Black-owned land, you know, working there, we would see our peers, you know, go through experiences in which trauma would surface for them because they would have some kind of connection to what their enslaved ancestors lived through, and these memories would come to mind. And so, you know, there needs to be an effort to reconcile with the land, to not see it as a site in which a crime was committed, but, you know, reclaiming it as a site for healing. And I went to Soulfire Farm with Adriana Diego and another comrade from Oxnard. And we went to New York where we attended different workshops to learn different farming skills. But we also learned many stories about the connection of our ancestors with the land, and that we don't have to work the land or in a conventional way. We can do it in a different way. And Naira, who's interpreting, I remember that she went to the Spanish version of that immersion. And then we later gathered and organized at the Abundant Table, and we replicated that same experience for other young people in the Oxnard area. And so this is something that we can do, is ask our parents to tell us their stories, that those stories that they carry that no one asked them about. And that is so important for the world and this climate crisis that we are facing. And, you know, it's so necessary in this unjust food system as well. And now we can move on with Juna, but I wanted to read Sophia's comment. She says that she forgot that, you know, H-2A visa workers is what her family works, or is something that she is learning more about. And so there are many more stories to share. Hopefully we can gather one day and write them down and, you know, just share so that we can grow a wealth of knowledge amongst us. So thank you to all the youth for sharing. And this requires so much courage. And as Florencia mentioned in the chat, this is about cross-pollination that is happening right now. And now I'm going to hand it over to Juna. Thank you, Kiki, and thank you to all the youth for your stories, your tears, your rage, and your hope, and for sharing all of that with us. As Kiki mentioned, this is not even the beginning of the conversation. It's a continuation, and it's something that we hope can be the beginning of a longer dialogue, because you know we only have a brief time here in Zoom, right? But now we're going to go on to the next part, which is a panel of folks who represent different communities and organizations so that they can share more about things going on with food justice issues. And I'm going to ask that the audience, if you all want to ask questions, please write them in the chat. And we will answer them, answer as many as possible. And for presenters, please remember that you can share in whatever language you feel comfortable in, and please take pauses for our interpreters. And we will start by asking our panelists to introduce themselves and share a little bit about the work that they do. So, Dalia Juvenal, could you start and then hand it over to Alice? Thank you, Juna. I'm going to talk a little bit about Tequio. Tequio, we are an indigenous youth group, and we work to take on issues about our cultural identity and the importance of cultural identity. At the same time, we work to dismantle all these negative connotations about what it means to be indigenous. Often, our own community, the Latina community, the Anglo-Saxon white community may have beliefs that indigenous people don't have education, that they are poor, that they are dirty, and that all they're meant to do in life is to work in the fields. And so us, as new generations, we want to resist and counter these ideas, and we want to reclaim what it means to be indigenous and to understand that we are peoples with a history, that our languages are just as valid as Spanish, English, or French, or any other language. And just as, you know, these languages exist in other places, our indigenous languages are just as valid, and they're historical, they're ancient. And so at Tequio, we work to reclaim our identity, to thrive in our identity, and so we can, you know, navigate this new current world. Many are born and grow up here in the U.S., but nonetheless, our families continue speaking our language, our traditions, and our mission is also to advocate for, you know, policy in the future, be it education or in the medical field, so that they can be more inclusive of indigenous communities, wherever they may be. For example, here in Santa Maria, there's a lot of Mixtec people from Oaxaca and Guerrero. And we also have a Purepecha community from Michoacán. And so that's me. My name is Dalia. I'm Mixtec from Oaxaca, and I am part of the Tequio youth group. And I'm going to hand it over to Juvenal. Thank you, Dalia. Before starting, I want to thank Dalia and the youth for all their stories. I was really touched, and I really identified with what they were sharing, because myself, I also started working at 7 years old. And, you know, I worked for 8 years picking strawberries. And after that, I had the opportunity to get to know the UFW with Cesar Chavez, right? And they invited me to be an organizer with them. I was with them for 6 years. And now with the Mixteco Indigenous Community Organizing Project, in March of this year, it was almost 17 years that I have been organizing the community here with my COP. And basically what we do is we are very focused in the area around labor issues for farm workers. So I'll leave you with that, and I'll leave you there with that so that we can answer more questions. And as Alia mentioned, my name is Juvenal Solano, and I am also Mixtec. And I think up next is Alex. I'm not sure. Thank you, Juvenal. We met a while back. I don't know if you remember. But I'm really happy to see you continuing the work. My name is Alice Winsmeyer, and I work around food justice issues. And I always say that the best part of our work is working with farm workers in a collaborative way. I'm with the Equitable Food Initiative, and we work to organize or support anybody within the agriculture system, from those who pick to those who drive the tractors, etc. And so, you know, we work to resolve labor conditions or conflicts around labor conditions. And we also work with the labor force, in which we support indigenous women primarily to make sure that they are valued for their creativity and experience and perspective, you know, all that they bring to the table. And the idea is to have them transform their own workplace culture to improve the lives of farm workers. And our mission is to transform the lives and the labor conditions of farm workers. So I'll hand it over to Juna. Go ahead, Juna. Thank you, Juvenal, Alice, Dalia. I forgot to introduce myself. My name is Juna, and I am a volunteer here in Ventura County with Encampment for Citizenship. And now I'm going to hand it over to Kiki so you can introduce yourself and the work that you do, and then you can send it over to Matthew. Thank you, Juna. Yes, I work with the Abundant Table, which is a nonprofit organization, and I was hired to build access to organic food in the areas where I grew up in Oxnard, Ventura, Santa Paula, which are areas in which many of us live in but don't have access to organic food, be it because there's no farmers market locally or because we can't afford it. And what we've done with this Abundant Table and the work we've done with Soulfire Farm is, you know, have food boxes in which we have a membership subscriptions to have organic food deliveries. And this also helps sustain the farm. And what we've done through this work is be able to expand this access to workers and families who would not otherwise be able to afford, this organic food. And so this is subsidized by the donations and income that comes from the community. So, you know, we have a way of just funneling these resources from people who have the resources to those who don't. And so we're able to sponsor, you know, up to like 16 boxes for 16 families. And this is something that we are able to organize and expand access for families to have, you know, food boxes every other week. So it's something very beautiful that we're building. And so that's a little bit of the work that we do. If you're interested in finding out more, you can visit our page, theabundanttable.org. And if you would like to donate a produce box for farm workers with no cost to them, you can also do that through our webpage. And now I'll hand it over to Matthew. Haku, haku.
No, ankchumash. Nunas limu swachas ka no an kaap ka kalap au hai. Greetings. I hope you're all.
I hope you all are well. My name is Matthew. Many call me that from my original Chumash name. And I am from the Santa Cruz Island, or Swahan, which is now called the Scorpion's Enclave. The main focus of my work is language revitalization. Primarily in Ventura County in the valley. And I have the honor of being on the board of directors for the defense of native languages in California. Many people don't know, but you know, all through California, there's about 300 native languages, and many of these are on the California-Mexico border. And it's one of the most diverse, linguistically diverse areas. And more pertinent to today, I am also the founder of an organization that is led by Chumash peoples. And this organization is under the fiscal sponsorship of CAUSE. We are working to later expand from that, but we do work to provide community education and rematriation to recover some of our lands. And so we also work on land restoration and work to engage and continue land-based education. So I feel very honored to be part of this event, because while we are not farm workers, we are open to learning and partaking in the wisdom that you all share, especially from your parents. So it is a new approach that we want to take. And I'm very excited to build these collaborations, right? We have to get rid of all these pesticides and whatnot. So thank you for having me. Thank you so much for being here, Matthew. I'm going to hand it over to Florencia so she can introduce herself. Hi, my name is Florencia Ramirez, and I am living in Oxnard. I am fourth generation. And I have had family who, you know, followed the farmworker caravan back in their day. And, you know, in following that work, I ask myself, can I, as a leader, have a broader impact on the world? Because we are in an era and times in which there is water scarcity. There's so much going on. And, you know, there's just wider, larger issues happening, affecting our planet. And so, you know, I've recently read a book discussing how to consume less water. And I have had discussions with local growers so that they understand, you know, what can be done to conserve water, right? And in regards to this other strawberry festival, I also want to consider, like, how many other languages have been brought into this space? And, you know, with this initiative of conserving water, it is connected to developing and preserving our languages, because we can't change anything unless we understand how to share with each other. And so, you know, coming into this space and talking about how we want to treat the land, the soil, but also talking about how people are treated, you know, we're all drops of water. And so when we think about this work that we do, it's beyond just conserving water. It's about the fact that when we come together for the well-being of our communities, we are helping people all over the world. You know, if food is contaminated, you know, or if our waters in the ocean are being, you know, if our fields contain pesticides, and these pesticides are eventually making their way into the ocean. And so, you know, even with the lettuce fields, that's what happens. And so when we partner with growers, you know, we need to understand that this contamination is a metaphor, right? If our rivers are healthy, then we are healthy. And so when we talk about composting, this came about from a national organization that trains young people to be social justice leaders in their own communities all across the US and other parts of the world. And so we've been doing this work since the 40s, or please let me know if I please correct me if I'm wrong. But our effort focuses also on working with young people to be able to build consciousness and awareness around carbon sequestration, water scarcity, you know, having the understanding that every time we go to a store or a public market, we are being part of the solution, right? And when we look for products that have a good story behind them, right, then that's important. But, you know, when we look at school cafeterias, we're feeding our children the cheapest food with least nutrients. We're not giving them nutritious food. And so, you know, through these compost parties that we hold in this initiative, the conversation is centered about how things should be, you know? So we started with a dialogue around composting, but it's soil composting, but it's transforming throughout this process. And we're starting new efforts to connect and heal everything. So I'm happy to be here, and I'm here to collaborate with and cultivate this cross-pollination through all kinds of different approaches, right? Because that's how we need to approach it. Some of us have very unique talents and we have a wealth of experience, and we absolutely need everyone and their talents to reimagine what this future can hold and how things should be for all of our people. Thank you, Florencia, for that beautiful vision that you shared. And for those who have been part of this session, we welcome any questions. I have a few questions for our panelists, but in the meantime, others can write theirs in the chat. And, you know, to start off, I wanted to ask Dalia if you would talk about the importance of identity, you know, cultural identity for young people. And, you know, I wonder if for you, Dalia, from your perspective, how is it that culture and identity play a role in food systems change? I think that one of the biggest things that have changed from my experience is the fact that we are now identifying as indigenous within, you know, this context of being poor or living in poverty. You know, sometimes we subscribe to these ideas that we are destined to not have access to healthy food, to the best nutrition. So, for example, one thing is that, again, in our family, we have, you know, this tradition of eating traditional food, beans, organic eggs from the hens that we have at home, you know, all of these healthy, nutritious food staples. But for our indigenous migrant community, all of this has changed because we no longer have time. You know, farm workers wake up at 4 or 5 a.m. They get their lunches ready for the day. They work 10 hours under the sun with a lot of pain. And then they get out of work and there's no longer space, time, or energy to be able to have, you know, constant access to cooking meals and having access to healthy foods. The first thing we do is go to foods that are more accessible, you know, commercialized, cheap, low nutritious food. And so we lose our customs of what we used to do in regards to what we eat. And so how is it that this connects to our cultural identity? Well, we have endured more than 500 years of racism and exploitation. Those of us who are indigenous to Mexico, you know, there's a lot of discrimination and racism against indigenous communities there. Indigenous communities are amongst the poorest in Mexico, and we have to migrate to the US, and here we are exploited as well in the fields, right? And as a comrade had mentioned, right, is how is it that our parents still work in the fields, but they don't have time or access to these organic foods? And, you know, these nutritious foods, right? Because within the market for all of this, there's just such little access. One needs to make good money to say, I'm going to go to the store and buy chia seeds or spirulina, you know, all of these superfoods that are so good for us that have indigenous origins, but that are not accessible to our community, you know, here in the U.S. These are luxury foods, what one could call it. And so I don't know if I'm answering the question, but, you know, there's just so much history that hasn't been considered, and that unfortunately right now there, I haven't seen a strong relationship between farm workers and growers in which they are paid, you know, and valued as they should be. And again, there's a lot of stigma in which we think that farm work is cheap and not valuable, right? So we're trying to rescue the fact that being a farm worker has dignity, but we also don't have to glorify and say, oh yes, we're people who can stand, you know, endure a lot. We have to do what's right. Allow, make it so that people, you know, are working 8 hours, but that those 8 hours be well paid. And, you know, there can be so many negative consequences to overworking, being around so many, exposed to so many chemicals, coming home and not having access to healthy food, health, health coverage, you know, there's so many things. Thank you, Dalia. And I'm gonna turn it back to Juvenal so that he can talk a bit more. As Dalia mentioned, you know, some of the conditions that farm workers face. And when we think about the strawberry industry and we understand there are so many difficult working conditions, you know, Juvenal, could you speak to some of the issues that you all are, labor issues that you all are working on in regards to farm workers? Well, unfortunately, the system or the industry is organized beyond the ways that farm workers are organized. So it's much more organized than farm workers. And so when workers are demanding rights, the system immediately begins to intimidate the worker, right? And this is the supervisors. And this is to prevent labor conditions from improving and prevent that there be salary increase, wage increases, and to prevent, you know, improvement of these conditions. That's a reality. So right now, farm workers in California, you know, we could say that only about 3 to 5% of farm workers are unionized. 95% do not have fair wages and fair working conditions. One example of what I can speak to is that here in Ventura County, it's very expensive to live. And the minimum wage this year is $14 an hour. That's a minimum wage, and that's legal. But that doesn't mean it's fair. And what I always say in regards to workers, you know, it's like laws, you know, can be put down in writing and be in effect, but that doesn't mean they're just. There's unjust things that happen that are legal. And this is the case with the minimum wage. And so for a worker to be able to live happily, as, you know, was mentioned previously, a farm worker right now is just working to get by, not to live and thrive. And so what we need to do is work together to bring about justice for farm workers so that we are not working for just a mere minimum wage, but that we work for a wage that honors dignity and justice for these workers. Because unfortunately, farm work is some of the worst paid labor. You know, people get by with a minimum wage, with basic treatment and basic working conditions. Personally, I have family that's still working in the fields. And, you know, I really like what one of the youth said is that, yeah, like some children have to go with a babysitter from 6, 5 a.m. And so, you know, at that stage in their life, children need their mother's, their father's care, their affection, you know, but they can't receive it because their parents have to go to work to make the money to pay rent and feed them, right? And so there comes a time for that child, you know, when they grow up, they don't feel the same affection for their parents. They no longer feel love for them. They say, you know, a weekend comes around and they say, do you want to go to the store? Do you want to go here? You know, kids don't want to go with them anymore. They have detached. They have learned to be on their own and have lost that love for their parents. And it's not the parents' fault. It's a system that forces that to happen because they are living through a miserable wages. And so currently we have seen that many workers are going on strike. And when the very, you know, the supervisors could say, you know what, these workers were on the front lines of this pandemic for over a year feeding the world. Does it have to be that farm workers have to go on strike to give them a better wages, to give a 2-cent increase? They're not asking for $1 or $2. They're just asking, give me a 2-cent, 10-cent increase. Whatever is fair. But there's no boss that says, you know what, you've been risking your life for more than a year, risking your health, your family. Here's $1 more per hour. No, they're not going to do that. They just meet the minimum wage. That's the law, and that's it. Bathrooms are dirty. They have no water to wash their hands. Two days ago, I was watching a video on Facebook because our community is on Facebook. That's really good because that's how we find out what's going on immediately. And so these workers went on strike here in Oxnard and some that went on strike in Santa Maria 3 weeks ago. Those who went on strike a few days ago in Oxnard was because the company, in some way, their system broke down, you know, the system that they use to tally how many boxes each worker picks, right? And so, you know, the worker said, well, if that system is broken, I'm not going to work today because if I work, you're not going to pay me all of the boxes that I'm going to pick. And I don't know if it was the supervisor or the owner came and said, you know what? Work today, you know, and be assured that we will be the ones who lose out as a company, not you all. You all will be guaranteed the minimum wage. That's what they told them, minimum wage. But in reality, this boss, they should be ready when things happen, when things like this happen, you know? So things like this happen, they should be ready to ensure that the worker is paid what they earned. Not just saying you're guaranteed the minimum wage. That's always what they come with, just meeting the minimum wage. But you can't live off of minimum wage, right? You get by with it. And so this is what we hear on the daily from farm workers. Mistreatment, bad working conditions, inadequate wages, no health coverage. And so right now there's so many workers age 25, 35, 40 years old. I'm not seeing as many young people work as when I was a farm worker. And so these workers, there will come a time when they will no longer be able to work. They'll get injured. Their bodies won't work the same. So what are we going to do for our workers to make sure that they are paid well and then we have a labor force that can continue working to provide food, but to make it a job that has dignity, that has justice? Because otherwise, those who will suffer will not only be the workers, but the rest of our community. Right now, we are paying a high price for organic food, but if we don't have a labor force that is well taken care of, well fed, well paid, then we're also gonna pay a high price for conventional food too. So we have to consider all of these things. So I'll leave you with that. I could share so much more, but I can share with you that farm workers deserve respect, justice, dignity. But if we don't find a way as a community to support, you know, legislation or bills that come about, for example, right now, there's a big push to pass a law that gives farm workers, not just farm workers, but all workers, 2 extra sick days. Currently, there's only 3 paid sick days. And so we are lobbying to increase that to 5 sick days. And so if you all in any way want to help us, you can speak with your assembly members, your senators, and, you know, share why it's so important to have those paid sick days for workers. And what we're saying is that it's very important to have at least 5 paid sick days. And this has nothing to do with COVID or anything else, because COVID, we have 80 hours. But that's going to come to an end, you know, at the end of the year. But what we're asking is that this be instated permanently. And so we as a community, you all can support. So if you all have any more questions, you can visit our webpage, www.mixteco.org. So I'll leave you with that. Thank you. Thank you so much, Juvenal. There's so much good information. And, you know, this is a lifelong knowledge that you're bringing to us by sharing all of these difficult labor conditions. We ask that you please check out MyCop's website and find ways to support. So now I want to hand it over with Alice, which is with the Equitable Food Initiative. And we want to talk more about EFI and talk about how this food justice initiative is being implemented in our community. Yes, it's an honor, and I truly appreciate being around and hearing from all of these dedicated advocates, especially you know, the youth leaders in our community. And how they are bringing to light all of the issues going on in this industry. And so we have this healthy food initiative to address all the brokenness of this system. And, you know, there's different unions. There's unions, there was workers, there's growers, and there's large buyers who are trying to figure out how to address the brokenness of the system on a larger scale and how to find a common interest among all stakeholders. So if you want to understand the brokenness of the system, then ask the people growing the food. You know, understand this food chain from the farm workers, the growers, to the supermarkets, to the consumers. So what is it that we can do collectively, right? So there's so many pieces that we can take part in this process. And we have, you know, there's leadership teams on the ranches that are working to address some of the environmental issues. And so we need to find a solution or a response for the strawberry industry. And so we have some incredible leadership teams working in the strawberry fields in California and in Mexico that have redesigned the carts that is used to transport the strawberries, which is less straining on the back. And that's you know, they're also, these teams are also looking to improve some working, some labor standards. Right, and ensuring that the workers are healthy enough to be in the fields and to do some conflict resolution when labor conditions and issues arise. So it's really about acknowledging what people have to bring to the table. And so it's about helping these workers understand their role in this food chain. And when we bring farm workers into these conversations, they can share from their own perspective about how to improve labor conditions at specific farms. But, you know, and this is a way in which they can coordinate with managers and supervisors and administrators to say, this is the kind of improvements we want to make in our fields, in our farms, and in our communities. So the idea is to address pesticide and labor issues. And we bring these to our stakeholder meetings so that we can have an immediate response in working through this collectively. And we actually have people who speak different languages in our leadership teams. When, you know, it may be indigenous communities, or when it's Canada, it's other languages, or Creole in Florida. And so it's important that we connect this, make these spaces to connect and identify worker issues and conditions. And in regards to pesticides management here in the strawberry fields, part of the difficulty is that this it's a year-long crop in which workers are harvesting constantly. And, you know, it's expensive to be working land that is so sandy, you know, being so close to the ocean. And so different assessments have to be made on these types of lands. And we work with our leadership team to figure out what it is that we are doing and kind of moving the needle to better practices. You know, I remember one of the workers on our teams with us in Oxnard, you know, spoke about how they use of pesticides is their last option now. And so involving all stakeholders in this process is part of what we do. But it's also about creating shared spaces for workers from the fields to share their insights and making sure that everyone is part of this process so that when audits are held, workers also have a voice and that they understand that their standards that their bosses have to work and abide by, and that they are consequences to not meeting these standards. So what we do in the strawberry fields has, and a lot of our certified farms we work with, is giving a voice and space and seat at the table for farm workers to work with growers and farm administrators. And, you know, then there becomes a more common understanding about what everyone's role in the workplace is. And we see working relations and communication improve. And we're able to connect workers and growers and administrators in a way in which workers feel represented. And we also have an advisory group to understand what worker needs are. And this is something that we've been able to create and build with clients like Whole Foods and Costco. And this is important because, you know, there's an investment of time in building relationships with the workforce. And then ensuring that in this labor that farm workers represented are paid for their labor, that there's be economic recognition of their knowledge. And hopefully consumers can be looking for this in the brands that they purchase from. And so it's time to really put our money behind our values to change the culture so that, you know, labor rights are truly respected. Thank you, Alice, for that, for sharing that vision of what a more equitable food system can be. Now I want to hand it over to Matthew. We have such a rich language exchange in this space. And, you know, with the work that you are doing in your life, how is it that language and land connect from your perspective? Thank you. I might stray from the topic, but I feel like I'm learning so much, so I don't know what I can contribute to the dialogue, but I'm gonna share about my culture. You know, part of the work that we're doing with our project is creating a map that is grounded in the land, in our language, and understanding that this is directly related to how our sacred foods are grown. And when the Spanish came, you know, I'm left very touched by something a youth said earlier, that this conflict about how people must take care of the land before taking care of people. Well, when the Spanish came, they came with this idea that God gave us the world as a gift. So for indigenous people, we are more about creation rather than creator. So, you know, if you want to honor God, you can honor God by honoring his creation. So in our culture, when we set the table, we see that as God. It's not a metaphor, you know. Our purpose is to harvest the fruits of the earth and live our life and take care of it. And recognizing that our lives are sustained by the death of others, be it a plant, an animal. And that's how life works around here in our cultures. And I think to consider, I'm only asking you to consider how we live, not to think like us, but to think that all of the foods that we gather, that we take in, you know, have taken, required the hard work of others for us to continue living. So sorry if I'm deviating a little bit. I'm not sure if I can answer that question directly, but I want to invite those who speak Mixteco or indigenous languages, Purépecha or Zapotec. You know, I want to say that it's okay to be trilingual. You know, when people come to the U.S., there's this perception or idea that we shouldn't, that we should quiet those languages. But I want to encourage you to continue speaking all the languages you speak and know. It can only make your life richer. And if there are any other questions, I can answer them, but nothing else comes to mind right now. That was beautiful. Thank you so much. Yeah, that's the connection that Leo was speaking about, you know, when he spoke about religion, right? There's a lot, we could go a lot deeper into that, even though it's not usually part of these discussions, right? But now I'd like to hand it over to Florencia. And we welcome any kinds of questions on the chat. So Florencia, if you'd like to share your vision for our community at a local level for a more just food system, and in California on the Central Coast too. Hi. So, you know, something that was brought to my attention right now that Juvenal was mentioning, you know, he was talking about survival, right? And just getting by. And I think about it in terms of the fact that if we were to ask ourselves, how can we better work together to make sure that workers can thrive, so that we can nurture the land, so that workers and the land can thrive, and understand that it's all connected, and take it to a larger scale, you know, at an industry level, if we think in those terms, it prompts us to think differently. You know, in this pandemic, we all want to go back to normal, the way things used to be, but do we really want to go back to where we were? This is an opportunity to think about everything in a different way. And it's time to think about how we grew up in our community, and especially in regards to our food, right? Like, what do we serve on our tables? Dalia mentioned it as well. You know, what we, the food that we give to our kids in the cafeteria. My kids right now are attending schools here in South Oxnard. And because of the pandemic, everything has been, you know, like, has to be wrapped in plastic. And, you know, it's just processed food. And the kids don't want to eat it. And so it's creating lots of trash. And so if we ask ourselves, how can we thrive? And if we go back to this reclamation of land, right? When I was writing this book, I spent quite some time in a farm in Washington, and I had there was a woman who had like a micro farm, and her son had been dealing with cancer because she used to take him to the strawberry fields. And we didn't understand that connection, that he used to go to Oxnard and pick strawberries. And she went from being a farm worker to being a farm owner. And she was able to take that leap through a farm incubator, a program that supported her in doing that. And making it so that she could, you know, lease some land at very low cost to practice regenerative agriculture. And to build opportunities for farm workers to become farm owners. You know, we switch over the focus on how do we grow nutritious food? How do we grow food free of pesticides? Right? And so what happens is that this system keeps moving forward and is handed down through different biological systems, animals, the soil, the land. And right now we're at a moment in which we have the opportunity not to go back to normal, to what was, but to create a path forward that is about really considering how we can thrive as a planet. And it's interesting because here on the screen, I see my dear friend Katie. You are like, you know, the poster child of these issues. And I just spent some time with Katie on the island of Oahu, and she tends to land there, 2-acre land there. And I realized that we all want to go to Hawaii because there's so much life, you know, it rains every day and you can feel the energy pulsating throughout. But that energy is here with us all the time. We just have to harness it and cultivate it. So thank you, Luna, for those words. You know, I'll carry them with me. That's my vision for the future, that wherever we may be, whatever our platform may be, and the work that we are doing, we must always think about how this you know, connects to my community, to the land, right? We're all connected. What's good for you is good for me. We are one. So I'll leave you all with that. Please stay connected with us, the Pesticide Free Soil Project, Encampment for Citizenships. We're recruiting youth for the summer between 15 to 19 years old. We would love for you all to be part of that project. And if you live in Ventura County, there are scholarships for our fellowship programs. So it's nice to have a mix of young and young people and adults, because we need everyone to be dreaming of a better future and a better present as well. So I'll leave you with that, and thank you everyone who stayed connected to this knowledge share, right? Yes, thank you to those who connected to this other strawberry festival. Matt, do you want to say something? Yes, well, I'm very inspired hearing of Florencia. You know, we share a connection of Washington. I went to school in Olympia. I'm not sure if you all have heard of an organization over there called Grub. I know that it has grown throughout the country. And I say it because even economic development has a lot to contribute, right? Grub is an organization that hires young people. And coming from underserved communities to assist in helping them grow their own food in their communities, right? Like setting up garden beds, providing seeds, and helping them set up their own community gardens, and their families receive produce boxes every week. And they, you know, approach restaurants to create like composting challenges, right? So it's it creates economic opportunity to augment what we're doing here. Thank you for that, Matt. There's so many beautiful visions that are coming together amongst these different communities and organizations in the Central Coast. So I just want to give any of you all the opportunity, if you have a brief message or question, and then we will close. Yeah, well, you know, with what you were saying earlier, I really felt that, Matthew, because I think it was one of the strongest connections I am able to make today, you know, learning from our indigenous ancestors. There's so much knowledge to gain there. There's so many ways of being with dignity. And being here for so long, I've been witness to the ways in which things have not even improved. They've actually gotten worse in regards to our food system. And sometimes we work to do harm reduction, but these things, you know, they continue in other ways, right? It used to be slavery with our African relatives, and now it's us. Why? Because our African enslaved ancestors, they fought for their rights, and now, you know, they needed to bring in labor from people who had no rights, which was the indigenous people, right? Indigenous people who don't consider themselves mestizos, right? This is what we see here in Oxnard, this discrimination against indigenous Oaxacan peoples. And so we need to consider the ways in which we need to dismantle this system to build a new one. And I truly believe it. I've seen it, that other cultures and societies, many of which we belong to, though we have lost those connections, we already carry those answers because there's thousands of years of knowledge, of trials and errors, of success, from which we have launched from. So if we keep ignoring them, we will continue to make the same mistakes. So we can reference many other worlds, right? Even with us, we've been taught to forget about this. There's a dominant world that has been imposed on us since 1492. But even so, there's worlds that exist within, without, and under this one. Many have been exterminated, but many are still here existing. And so, you know, as Florencia mentioned, if the river is healthy, we are healthy. We are not apart or separate from nature. We're not superior, even though we've been taught that we are and that we must control it or dominate it. But if we perpetuate that cycle time and time over again, and maybe, you know, next up will be another community of immigrants, you know, I just want to say that I've seen and I know that there's other ways that we can be, and that we can gather ancestral knowledge with what we know today in a way that helps us honor all of its importance. Thank you. That is such a beautiful closing. Please, please, if you're still in this call, stay connected. There's some links in the chat that you can access. And we will also be sharing a Oaxacan music playlist. There's also a link for an indigenous cookbook. And you can also support the Tequio Youth Group and their scholarship by making a donation. And you can also support the Abundant Table via, whether it be your financial support or spreading the word in the community. We appreciate that you have stayed connected. Thank you once again to the organizers of this event, the panelists, to all the young people in particular, those in front of the camera and behind the scenes, to the coordinators and our interpreters, Naira and Alice. We hope to continue the conversation, and I'll hand it off to Sonia. Please help us by playing some Oaxacan music. And thank you to those who have joined from across the country.
Sonia, I don't think there's any audio.
De lo que se robaron un pueblo escondido en la cima, mi piel es de cuero, por eso aguanta cualquier clima. Soy una fábrica de humo, mano de obra. Humo, mano de obra campesina para tu consumo. Frente de frío en el medio del verano, el amor en los tiempos del cólera, mi hermano. Soy el que nace y el día que muere, con los mejores atardeceres. Soy el desarrollo en carne viva, un discurso político sin saliva. Las caras más bonitas que he conocido, soy la fotografía de un desaparecido. La sangre dentro de tus venas, soy un pedazo de tierra que vale la pena, una canasta con frijoles. Soy
soy Maradona contra Inglaterra, anotándote dos goles. Soy lo que sostiene mi bandera, la espina dorsal del planeta en mi cordillera. Soy lo que me enseñó mi padre, el que no quiere a su patria, no quiere a su madre. Soy América Latina, un pueblo sin pierna, pero que camina. Oye,
tú no puedes comprar al viento, tú no puedes comprar al sol.
Pa' cuando me sonrío, la nieve que maquilla mis montañas. Tengo el sol que me seca y la lluvia que me baña. Un desierto embriagado con peyote, un trago de pulque para cantar con los coyotes. Todo lo que necesito tengo a mis pulmones respirando azul clarito. La altura que sofoca, soy las muelas de mi boca mascando coca. El otoño con sus hojas desmayadas, los versos escritos bajo la noche estrellada. Una viña repleta de uva, un cañaveral bajo el sol en Cuba. Soy el mar Caribe que vigila las casitas haciendo rituales y agua bendita. El viento que peina mi cabello, soy todos los santos que cuelgan de mi cuello. El jugo de mi lucha no es artificial porque el abono de mi tierra es natural.
Tú no puedes comprar el viento, tú no puedes comprar el sol. Tú no puedes comprar la lluvia, tú no puedes comprar el calor. Tú no puedes comprar las nubes, tú no puedes comprar los colores. Tú no puedes comprar mi alegría, tú no puedes comprar mis dolores. No se puede comprar un vento, no se puede comprar el sol. No se puede comprar la lluvia, no se puede comprar el calor. No se puede comprar.
Tampoco pestañeo cuando te miro para que te recuerdes de mi apellido. La operación Cóndor invadiendo mi nido. Perdono, pero nunca olvido. Oye,
vamos caminando, aquí se respira lucha. Vamos caminando, yo canto porque se escucha.
Thank you, Sonia, for putting together the music. I can't wait to listen to the entire playlist.
Yes, hope everybody enjoys it. Happy Sunday.
That's how I'm going to celebrate just now. I got my beverage. Now I'm going to have my music and I can grow well-being. My own at the moment.
Yes.
All right. Sending everybody love and light. Bye.
Bye.
Thank you all.